Hello everyone, today I am here with a new video. The video is on quadratic programming. In my previous video, I have explained you about from where we get the concept about quadratic programming. And I have explained you about a flowchart from for programming problem. Now this is the second video, which is in this we will discuss about the Kuhn Tucker conditions. First point. And second point, we will take a problem. How we can apply Kuhn Tucker conditions, okay, on a given quadratic problem, okay. So these two things we will discuss in detail in this video. So please watch this video from start to end very carefully, because I think by the end of this video you understand very well about what is Kuhn Tucker conditions and how we can apply those on the given quadratic problem. Now let us start about the Kuhn Tucker conditions. It is about non-negative constraint. The first point is, I have written the conditions usually which comes in exam in the form of the points, because I personally feel that if you have something, if you have a data given in a points, it will easy for you to understand, as well as it is easy for you to remember and to write, okay. So this way only usually I write in my exams. So before starting, I want to just give you I want to just make a request that please subscribe my channel if you feel my videos are helpful for you, and post a comment regarding your problem as well as your suggestions for my channel. Now let us start. The necessary and sufficient Kuhn Tucker conditions to get an optimal solution to the problem, that means about quadratic problem of maximizing the given quadratic objective function subjected to the linear constraint. So here we are discussing about the necessary and sufficient condition for a Kuhn Tucker method, okay. And the Kuhn Tucker method help us to obtain an optimal solution for a quadratic programming problem. The problem is of maximization type and the objective function is a quadratic type. The constraint is of a linear type. I hope this first stanza is clear to you. Consider the following general form of NLPP, which is having a maximized objective function with all less than or equal to type of constraint. So we have an objective function of max form and the constraint or the inequalities of less than equal to symbol. The representation of objective function is max of z is equals to function of x1, x2, so on, xj, xn are the n variables. Subject to constraint is written as, usually we write it here as a, but here we are representing it as g, gi, x1, x2, so on, xj, xn. This is the left hand side of a inequality, less than equal to symbol, and bi is the right hand side constraint of an inequality where I varies from 1 to n. And the xj is the representation of a variable. The j value of the j is from 1 to n. It has always been greater than equal to 0. So this is the general form of NLPP. Okay. Getting the mathematical representation, we have to start stepwise. So step 1 is, convert the inequality constraint into equation by introducing the slack variable. Okay. So we have to convert the less than sign into equal to sign, and for that, if you remember, in case of LPP in the simplex method, we introduce the slack variables. So here, as this is a quadratic programming problem, we will introduce slack as a square of the value, that means SI square. Now I am saying it SI square here in this, while in my next video I'll be using this as qi square, ri square. So in different books they have used different symbols for slack variable. You know this as you have already finished your simplex portion. So in different books, different authors use different symbols, but the representation, only the alphabets is different, the representation is same. That it is SI square, somewhere it is used as QI square, somewhere it is RI square, but we will be taking the square of it value, okay, the quadratic value. Now slack variable, we will be taking the square of the value. Now the slack variable is SI square. In the ith constraint, I varies from 1 to m. Now second point is, slack variable S square m plus j in the jth non-negative constraint. That I will tell you in non-negative constraint, what it mean by this, okay. So we introduce the square, s square I value in the ith constraint means here. Here we introduce si to s square m plus j, okay, or s m plus j whole square we have introduced in case of non-negative constraint. That means these are the values of x. For an example, if you have two number of variables in your given problem, so the new set of equations will be like x1 plus minus of x1 plus s square. You have to give the number depending on the numbers you have used. After that, the same you have to process in the ascending order. That I will explain you during my when I solve the problem. Okay, so the second equation representation and gi value is equals I x1 x2 so on xj xn is equals to aij xij. That means this gi represents the matrix. That means it represents the left hand side, which I already told you many times. This represents the left hand side with the variables of the constraint. I hope this thing is clear to you. Okay, we can replace it with help of a11 x1 plus a12 x2 plus so on. Here we introduce the slack variable s1 square is equals to bi b1, and when we take b1 to the left hand side, it will become minus b1 equal to 0. I hope this thing is clear to you. Similarly, we can add the slack variables in the number of given constraint. Now, what is this? This is if in my given problem I'm having only two variable, for an example x1 and x2, then two new equations will form with help of non-negative constraint is minus of x1 plus, if I used s1 s2 here, then s3 square is equals to something 0, then minus of x2 plus s4 square is equals to 0. This thing I will explain you again with respect of problem, but only I'm giving you an overview kind of a thing so that you will not get confused. So this will be step number 1. Okay, number 2 is to construct the Lagrangian function. Lagrangian function is always represented by L, capital L. The function will be with respect of the variable x, as we have unknown variable x. S, the slack variable, lambda is a Lagrangian constant, which is equal to fx means the function of x, minus times of summation I equal to 1 till m lambda I. That means you have to find the values, you have to write these. What is this? These are the inequalities. If we replace this thing, this is step number 1. In step number 1, this is the objective function, these are the constraint. If I replace this from here, if I replace this section from this section, so you can see it is just a similar summation of aij xj minus of bi si square. So this is the inequalities, okay, the constraint, and this is lambda I, you have to multiply with it. Then after that, lambda times of this thing, these are the equations with respect to non-negative constraint. Okay, the newly formed equations, you can say. So it is here. So these three values will include and form a Lagrangian function. Okay, the function, objective function here with a positive sign, while these two constraint section means the in equation sections will be with a minus sign, multiply with a Lagrangian constant. Okay, so now the third point is step number 3. After writing the functions and constraint in the form of Lagrangian function, you have to find the first partial derivative of the Lagrangian function with respect to the variable of x, with respect to the variable s, with respect to the Lagrangian constraint, whichever we have written here, with respect to them, you have to find a first partial derivative of a these values. Okay, form of del L upon delta xj. The condition is this should be equal to 0, and then after putting this equal to 0, we obtain a equation 0 del L upon del S equal to 0, and find the condition. The above condition are called as Kuhn Tucker conditions. Okay, now I hope this Kuhn Tucker condition is, at least half of it is clear to you. Now the remaining half of it I will explain you in my this problem. because I know it is not very easy to understand if you are watching my video first time about quadratic programming. It takes time, at least you have to read this conditions and do the problem once or twice, only then concept is clear to you. But what I suggest, this question is not very difficult because very less calculation is there in Kuhn Tucker. In Wolfe's method it is like a simplex method, but in Kuhn Tucker it is not. So please watch this video at least once or twice or thrice, at least thrice, and then prepare 2-3 questions, then you will be quite confident how to do that in an exam. Let's start. Now the question one is, find the Kuhn Tucker conditions of a following quadratic programming problem. So this is a quadratic programming problem. Now how you can say that this is a quadratic programming problem? Because it contains 2x1, it is find 3x2 minus times of 2x1 square. So this says that an objective function is a non-linear type, first point. The given two constraint, the objective function is a non-linear type, subject to, these are the two constraint, and the constraint are purely linear type. So this says the given problem is a quadratic problem and the unrestricted variable. Now start solving it. Now first step is to convert the given problem into the general form of NLPP, that is objective function should be in max and the given inequalities is less than equal to sine. So I just write it again. The objective function is a max form and then the subject of constraint is in less than equal to sine. Okay, so I'll just write it here. Max of z is equals to, I just copy it here, 2x1 plus 3x2 minus 2x1 square. This I have termed as 1. Okay. Now subject to, we have two values, x1 plus 4 of x2 here. x1 plus 4x2 is less than equal to 4. This is this one. So I have just written here. Then second one is x1 plus x2. x1 plus x2 is less than equal to 2. And how many variables are used? 2 variables are used. So we can write it like this, minus of x1 less than equal to 0, minus of x2 is less than equal to 0. So this is 2 and this is 3. Okay, we will write it like this. This is the step number 1. Now step number 2. Now convert the inequality into equation by introducing the slack variable, because all the symbols used is of less than sign. So we introduce the slack variable. Okay, now introduce the slack variable, just copy it from here. x1 plus 4x2 plus 1s1 square. Now next is x1 plus x2 plus 1s2 square minus of x1 plus 1s3 square minus of x2 plus 1s4 square. It is equal to 0, equal to 4, equal to 2, equal to 0, equal to 0. Now, I hope this is clear to you. Now, how to obtain the Kuhn Tucker conditions? We construct for to obtain the Kuhn Tucker conditions. So step number 3, it's a very important step in this question. To obtain a Kuhn Tucker conditions, we construct a Lagrangian function. See, Kuhn Tucker method, theoretical concept is very difficult to understand. But the problem is very easy to write and to solve. Okay. So please don't leave this if this chapter is in your syllabus. Prepare it, because very less calculation is there for Kuhn Tucker condition. But yeah, for Wolfe's it is. Now don't waste time. Let's now just start. To obtain Kuhn Tucker conditions, we construct the Lagrangian function. Lagrangian function. Now how many variables we have? Now I'll just tell you the variables x1, x2. Okay. Then s1, s2, s3, s4. So x1, x2, s1, s2, s3, s4. Now Lagrangian constant for all four equation. So lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, lambda 4. So these all are the variables with respect to the Lagrangian function. Now we write it like this. This one. If you remember, I have explained you here how to construct a Lagrangian function. For construction of a Lagrangian function, you have to write the objective function. Fx represents objective function. So first I write my objective function here. Okay, first I write my objective function. My objective function I will copy from here, 2x1 plus 3x2. So I'll write it like this, 2x1 plus 3x2 minus times of 2x1 square, then minus times of, see, minus times of lambda I. So I will use lambda 1, lambda, this is the objective function, okay, lambda 1. Then after that, I have to use the constraint one by one. That is the given, we have converted them in an equation. So that means the new equations one by one. So lambda 1, this is the first equation I just termed is as 1 dash, 2 dash, 3 dash, 4 dash. I hope it is clear to you. So lambda 1 into 1 dash, lambda 2 into 2 dash, lambda 3 into 3 dash, lambda 4 into 4 dash. So lambda 1 into this full x1 plus 4x2 plus 1s1 square and minus times of 4, and this is equal to 0. We can write it like this, minus times of 4 equal to 0, minus times of 2 equal to 0, because we have to find the derivative. So this will be easy for us to do. So this minus times of lambda 2. Lambda 2 means in 2 dash. So that means x1 plus x2 minus times of s. I have copied it here, minus 2. Then after that, lambda 2. Then lambda 3. With that, you have to copy this third dash, 3 dash, minus x1. x1 plus 1 s3 square, then minus lambda 4 minus x2 plus s4 square. Okay, so this is it. You have represented this in a Lagrangian function form. Now this is step you never see in the books, but I have included this because this will help you while solving the partial derivatives. So separating coefficient of x1 and x2. So we will take the x1 coefficient one side. So it will become 2. Then minus minus plus lambda 3. Okay. Then minus 2x1 square. Okay. Then plus times of x2. 3. Minus 4 lambda 1. 4 lambda 1. 1 lambda 2. Minus 1 lambda 2. Plus lambda 4.
Okay. The separating coefficient of x1 and x2 step is totally optional, but this will help us in solving the partial derivatives as we will get the values of x1 and x2. Okay. Now lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, lambda 4 values we will get from the above line which I have already written. Okay. Now after that, after separating the coefficients, we will move towards the solving the partial derivatives. Okay. Now we will do the partial derivatives of all the coefficients from x1 till of lambda 1 and for s. Okay. Now move to find the partial derivative.
Then step number 4. Step number 4, the necessary and sufficient condition here. The first partial derivative of L with respect to x, that means x1 and x2, we have two variables in our partial derivative of L with respect to the variables. So we have variables like x1, x2, then s1, s2, s3, s4, okay, and then with respect to lambdas. So I have written it like this, okay, and also with respect to s and lambda. Now you have to solve del L upon x1. So del upon del x1 with respect to x1. So we have to see the variables values of x1. Okay, we copy this there because we have to find the partial derivative with respect to x1, so all becomes 0. So we want this value, so I'll write it here like this, 2 minus lambda 1 minus lambda 2 plus lambda 3 plus 4x1 equal to 0. So equal to 0 is the condition. Okay, you have to equate this partial derivative equal to 0 and then you will get in a form of the equation. When we solve it, what we will get? We will get this 2 minus lambda 1 minus lambda 2 plus lambda 3 plus 4x1 equal to 0. This I will term as first. Okay, now next is this del L upon del x2. So I will write del upon del x2 and the value of x2, 3 minus 4 lambda 1 minus lambda 2 plus lambda 4 equal to 0. What it gives you? 3 minus 4 lambda 1 minus lambda 2 plus lambda 4 equal to 0. Okay, this I have termed as second. Use of the terms which possess s1. So this is 1, lambda 1 s1 square. Only one is there. Del upon del s1 minus lambda 1 s1 square. So this will give you minus times of 2 lambda 1 s1 which is equals to 0. Okay. Then next is del L upon del s2 minus lambda 2 s2 square. It will give you minus 2 lambda 2 s2 equal to 0. Minus lambda 3 s3 square. So del L upon del s3 it is equals to minus lambda 3 s3 square. It will give you 2 lambda 3 s3 equal to 0. After this, we have to find del L upon del lambda 1. So, for lambda 1, you can get the value from here. Okay. So, I will just copy it here. S4 S2 plus S1 square minus 4. So, this will give you X1 plus 4 X2 plus S1 square minus 4. And every time for necessary and sufficient condition, we have to equate this partial derivative equal to 0. Okay. So, this will give you value as X1 plus 4 X2 plus S1 square equal to 4. So, I have termed this as 1. Okay, you will get an equation from here as well. Minus lambda 1 minus lambda 2 plus lambda 3 plus 4 x1 equal to 2. I will take 2 that side. Similarly, minus 4 lambda 1 minus lambda 2 plus lambda 4 equal to minus 3. I will take 2 that side. It will become minus of 2. I will take 3 on next side, means on right hand side. It will become minus of 3. This first one is 1. Then this is 2. Okay. Now here, I'll write it like 3, okay. Now again next one, del upon del lambda 2, value of L with respect to lambda 2, it is here. We will not opt for minus sign, we'll take the inside value. So lambda 2 into x1, x2, x1 plus x2 plus s2 square minus 2, minus 2. Now, by taking the partial derivative, we'll get x1 plus x2 plus s2 square minus of 2 and this equate to 0. It will give you x1 plus s2 plus x1 plus x2 plus s2 square equal to 2. This I'll termed as 4. Now, del L upon del lambda 3. So, lambda 3, you have this one. So, it is del upon del lambda 3, this value. Lambda 3 into minus x1 plus s3 square minus x1 plus s3 square, it will give you minus x1 plus s2 square equal to 0. Okay, now next is del upon del lambda 4, it will become lambda 4 into this one minus x4 plus s4 square. So
in above it is s3 square. Now solving this one equal to, this is minus x1 not x4 plus s4
whole square equal to 0. Okay, I hope this is clear to you. Apart from that, I want to tell you one thing more, that in this question, this I just marked these equations as 1, 2, we got the values as 3 and 4. So this we will be going to use in the Wolfe's method in my next video. Okay. So I hope this Kuhn Tucker condition as well as the solved problem is clear to you. If you have any query, please post the comment in a comment box below. And please subscribe my channel. And if you feel videos are helpful for you, thank you.